नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स। नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स। नमो तस्स भगवतो अरहतो सम्मा संबुद्धस्स। इद भिक्खवे अरे सावको पानातिपातं पहाय। पानातिपाता पतिविरतो होति। पानातिपाता पतिविरतो भिक्खवे अरे सावको अपरिमाणानां सत्तानां अभयं देति अवीरं देति अव्यापद्यं देति अपरिमाणानां सत्तानां अभयं दत्त्वा अवीरं दत्त्वा अव्यापद्यं दत्त्वा अपरिमाणस्य अभयस्य अवीरस्य अव्यापद्यस्य भागी होति। Dear devotees and all Dhamma friends, first of all, I am very much happy to have to deliver a Dhamma talk at London Mindfulness Meditation Center, UK, on the auspicious occasion of Vaisakh Purnima Day. And I am also very much thankful to my brother Man, Venerable Nipaveswamana, who is multi-talented monk and also the chief abbot of London Mindfulness Meditation Center. Vaisakh Purnima Day is very much important to us as three events in the life of the Buddha took place on this very Purnima Day. So we can mention the birth of the Siddhartha Bodhisattva and the enlightenment of the Bodhisattva and the passing of the Buddha took place on this very Purnima Day. These three events are regarded as auspicious events in the life of the Buddha. We can realize the birth of the Buddha and enlightenment of Bodhisattva could be regarded as auspicious events because these events are very much beneficial for all the sentient beings in the whole of the world. But even the passing away of the Buddha is taken as an auspicious event. What is the reason for that? As you know, though the Buddha had eradicated all the mental defilements from his mind, and he has no suffering mentally, as long as he exists in this world, or if not his body exists in this world, he has to face any kind of difficulties and sufferings occur to his body. For example, we can remind here at the last hour in the life of the Buddha, when he suffered from kind of diarrhea. So he suffered very much physically. When the Buddha passes away, then he has not to face any kind of physical difficulties and suffering. So he's totally free of suffering when he passes away. So in that sense, the passing away of the Buddha could be regarded as an auspicious event. So recollecting these three auspicious events in the life of the Buddha, we perform various meritorious deeds on Vaisakh Purnima Day. So now we are ready to listen to Dhamma talk. So that is regarded as also very important meritorious deed or wholesome deed. Kalin Dhamma Savana. Itam Mangala Muttama. In the Mangala Sutra, it is mentioned that listening to the Dhamma, listening to the religious discourses from time to time, so it is very much beneficial fact for all of us. The topic of today's Dhamma talk is Abhisandha Sutta from අංගුත්තර නිකාය අටක නිපා. Labhisandh Sutta explains about it benefits to a person who takes refuge to the triple gem, Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha, and who observes five precepts and upholds five precepts. So basically, we can mention here in Abhisandha Sutta, the benefits of cultivating morality are described. So morality is very much important in the life. That is called in Pali, sila, moral behaviors. We can say an ethical code in the life. So in many places, the Buddha describes on morality. When he describes about three types of meritorious deeds, namely dana, sila, bhavana. Secondly, it comes sila, morality. The first one is dana, that is generosity. Whatever we have, whatever we possess, if we give away for the benefit of others, that is called dana, that is called generosity. And the moral behavior is regarded as moral conduct, is regarded as morality, sila. And third one is bhavana, that is meditation. When the Buddha described three types of trainings, that is called trisiksha, in the first place, it comes morality. The first one is sila, morality. And second one is samadhi, that is concentration. And third one is panya, that is wisdom. To attain the wisdom, firstly, we have to cultivate the morality. After cultivating morality, only could be achieved concentration in the mind, that is for samadhi. And after one has developed concentration very well, one can attain the panya or wisdom. So therefore, the moral behavior or moral conduct, morality is very much important. So when we discuss on morality, the five precepts predominantly very much important. That is called Panchasila. The Buddha has mentioned in many places in Pali canonical literature about five precepts. In all of the Nikayas of the Sutta Pitaka, we can see the description of five precepts. In the Digha Nikaya, in Aghani Sutra, we can see the mentioning of the four precepts among the five precepts, except the fifth one. The earlier four precepts are described in Aghani Sutra. And in Brahmajala Sutra, as I mentioned, we can see the mentioning of five precepts. And in the Singhalavat Sutra, or Singhal Sutra, so you can see the description of five precepts there. And in the Majjhima Nikaya, also in many sutras, we can find the description of five precepts. And in Sanghita Nikaya, and even in Anguttara Nikaya, specifically, Panchaka, Chatta, Sattaka Attaka Nipata, so description of five precepts could be found. And in Khuddaka Nikaya also, in many sutras, for example, in the Dhammika Sutra, these five precepts are described. So therefore, it's very much important, specifically, the lay devotees and also the monks and nuns. And before we observe five precepts, we take refuge into triple gem, Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha. And after that, we recite these five precepts. Specifically in Theravadin countries like Sri Lanka, made by Thailand. When any kind of religious ceremonies are held, so before the holding of any kind of religious ceremonies, these 5 questions are observed. And observing only is not sufficient. We have to uphold and bring to practice these 5 precepts of Panchasila. As you know, the first precept is Panatipata Vedamana Sikkhapada Samadhiya. The meaning of this is, I undertake the training rule to abstain from taking life any kind of sentient being, or I abstain from killing. And second one is Adinnadana Vedamana Sikkhapada Samadhiya. The meaning of this Pali text is, I undertake the training rule to abstain from taking what is not given. So that is abstain from stealing. And third one is Kamesa Micchachara Vedamana Sikkhapada Samadhiya. The meaning of this Pali text is, I undertake the training rule to abstain from sexual misconduct, for illicit or improper sexual conduct. And the fourth one is Musavada Vedamana Sikkhapada Samadhiya. The meaning of this text is, I undertake the training rule to abstain from wrong speeches, not only false speeches, all kinds of wrong speeches. I abstain from all kinds of wrong speeches. The fifth one is Suramiriya Majitamadatana Vedamana Sikkhapada Samadhiya. The meaning of this text is, I undertake the training rule to abstain from taking any kind of intoxicants which lead to heedlessness or carelessness. So when we discuss one by one of these precepts, firstly we can mention that on the killing or taking the life of any kind of sentient beings. So every person wishes to live and not to wish die, wishes to die. Everyone is fond of pleasure and adverse to pain. So in the Dhammapada, the Buddha mentioned in the Gatha or in a formula, Sabbe tasanti dandasa, sabbe bhayanti macchuro, attana bhukman kattva nahanyi inka. Sabbe tasanti dandasa, all sentient beings are secure of punishment, any kind of punishment. All the sentient beings are secure. And all the sentient beings are secure of death. No one likes to die, everyone likes to live. So comparing such kind of feelings of awe, attana upman kattva, or if not, keeping similes of our own such kind of feelings, nahane yena ghate, one should not harm or one should not hurt any kind of living beings. So if someone were to kill us, It would not be pleasing or delightful to us. Also, if one kills another who wants to live and not to die, it would not be pleasing or delightful to the other person. So something, so that is not pleasing to oneself, must also be pleasing to another. So therefore, something that is not pleasing to oneself should not be imposed on another. And when we discuss the abstaining from the killing living beings, so we can say that some factors, or we can mention that 5 conditions should be met. They specifically mentioned in Arthasalin. The Arthasalin is a commentary to Dhammasangha. Dhammasangani is a text of Abhidhamma Pitaka. There are 7 texts of works in Abhidhamma Pitaka in Pali. So among them, Dhammasangha is one of the texts included in Abhidhamma Pitaka. And Attisalani is commentary to that text of Dhammasangha. In this commentary, Attisalani just mentioned, so five conditions should be met for killing to take place. The first point is there should be a being. So that being must be alive, not the dead one, so that living being should be alive one. And the second point is there must be knowledge that it is a living being. So we should know. So this living being is alive, not dead. So such kind of knowledge should be there. And third point is there must be intention to cause its death. That means there should be volition to kill. The volition, the intention is very much important fact in concept of karma or in the concept of action. So according to Buddha, Buddhism, Chetanan Vikre Kamma Muda, the Buddha mentioned, the volition is itself action. When there is a volition, then it becomes karma. So without volition, any kind of deeds could not be regarded as the karma or action. So the volition is very much important. The third point is the volition or intention to kill. And the fourth one is the action must be taken to cause its death. This is the action, the kind of any kind of process for killing. And the fifth one is this death must result from such action. When these three facts or three conditions may, then the killing occurs. Killing will be fulfilled. And when we discuss about conditions for killing, the first important point to note is that there must be an intention of volition to kill. The volition is actually, as I mentioned earlier, it's a mental factor or chetasika, which is responsible for the action or karma. Without intention, there is no transgression. As I accidentally kill any ant while trying to pull it away from our body to prevent it from biting us. Killing is classified as the moral bodily action, kayika kamma, since it generally occurs via the body. But what truly performs the act is the mind using the body as its instrument. The second important point is that the action taken to cause death need not occur directly through the body. So it can be carried out by giving a kind of command to kill, and by way of words, writing, or gesture. The one who issues such a command becomes responsible for the action as an as. It achieves the intention of killing a living being. In extreme cases, killing can be effected by occult practice or supernatural powers. The third important point to note is that the precept is transgressed only when one is aware that the object of one's action is a living being. Thus, if someone washes vegetables without knowing that there are caterpillars or any kind of other insects on the leaves and kills them, the precept is not transgressed because there's no volition, there's no intention to kill. Without knowing, some living beings may be dead. The last of the being must die as a result of this action. Thus, if a killer is chasing his victim with a knife, an intention of killing him, but the latter accidentally trips on a rock, breaks his head, resulting in death. Although the victim died, his death was accidental, and not killing has taken place. That is, the person who chases creature is not responsible for his killing. And when we discuss on the factors affecting the gravity of the act of killing, so we can mention here, firstly, that with regard to moral qualities, human victims are said to possess moral qualities, while animal victims are said to possess no moral quality. So the killing of a human being is graver than killing an animal. But killing any kind of sentient being is kind of a sinful act. So killing animal is could not be regarded, or killing animal or any kind of small insects could not be regarded as the normal action or free of sin. It's also a sinful act. But according to the moral position, the gravity or the heaviness of the common lies. Among humans, the most serious or grievous is the killing of one's mother, father, and parents, and also a sinful being, the arahant. To kill a person with super spiritual qualities or to kill one's benefactor is more than worthy than to kill an immoral or an unrelated person. In the case of animal victims also, the gravity of the act generally depends on its size. It is mentioned in Atasalni, so the commentary, but whatever size may be the kind of living beings, so it is sinful act to kill such kind of living being. But in this commentary is mentioned according to size, the gravity depends of the come of the killing. With regard to defilements and effort, a cold-blooded murderer intended and planned in advance and rooted in strong greed or hatred carries more weight compared to impulsively carrying out in defeat or race in self-defense. The unwholesome volition involved in the thinking and planning of the murder far outweighs those involved in an impulsive killing. The presence of cruelty or torture and obtaining of sadistic pleasure from the killing further increases its gravity. So when we discuss on the second precept, that is abstaining from stealing or abstaining from taking what is not given, it's also mentioned in Atasalni the five conditions should be made to occur this kind of transgression of the precept. So first fact is mentioned as there should be material or there should be an article belonging to another legally or blamelessly. This is the first point. And second point is knowledge that material or article belongs to another, not to myself, or not to me, or belong, or not to own, but belong to someone else. You should have some kind of knowledge. This is the second point. And third one, there must be the intention to steal. Again, the volition, the chetana, is also mentioned in this condition also. And fourth one, action must be taken to steal. There should be process to steal. And fifth one, by the action, by this kind of process, the material must be taken or stolen. And there are also many types of stealing or taking what is not given. The most blatant image involving threats of force are daylight robbery and extortion, purse snatching, kidnapping. The second type of stealing could be mentioned here. secret taking any kind of material without the honest knowledge, such as housebreaking, burglary, and pickpocketing. The third type of steal is mentioned here is fraud. With the fraud, laying false claims or cheating by confidence texters to gain someone's possessions. And fourth one is the deceit, when dishonest traders cheat their customers by false weights and measures or supply products of lower quality than specified. And the fifth one is, we can mention here, forgery, when people pass counterfeit money as real or sell counterfeit gold and jewelry. The last type of the stealing, it seems like it's very common and occurs when employees take the tiny or small items from the company for their own use without paying for it. And when we mention or describe on the gravity of taking what is not given or stealing, so we can mention here even that the moral qualities of the victim and the value of the material. Firstly, stealing from a moral virtuous person or benefactor is more blameworthy or graver than stealing from an immoral person or an unrelated person. Secondly, we can mention that stealing a valuable article is more blameworthy than stealing an article of little value. However, the value of a material need not be equated with its cash value. So how much is expensive is not equated. Thus, stealing an alms bowl from a meditative monk who uses it to collect food is definitely more severe, as mentioned in this text, than stealing several $1,000 from a rich person. Similarly, stealing the lecture notes from a student preparing for his exams will cause more grief to the victim than stealing his TV set, because the lecture notes are very much important for that student than the TV set. And the mental relations behind the action and the force of defilements also contribute to the gravity of the act, with hatred being considered more severe than greed. And when we discuss on the third precept, the abstain from sexual misconduct, so it's also, I'm sorry very much for interruption in the listening number talk, as here in Nepal, the internet went off. So now we can start from the place we are. We start on this Dhamma talk. So we are discussing on five precepts, and we have reached for the third precept. The third precept is abstention from sexual misconduct. Now, Ms. Mitchell, we will see Captain Samadhi. And in the Atasarani, it is also mentioned the four points should be made to transgress this precept, for the third precept. So the first point is mentioned here. There must be a man or woman with whom it is improper to have sexual intercourse. And second point is, there must be intention to have sexual intercourse with such a person. So again, here is mentioned about volition, the intention to have such kind of sexual intercourse or sexual behavior. And third point is, action that must be taken to have such an intercourse. There should be a process to have such kind of intercourse again. And the fourth point is, there must be enjoyment from the sexual misconduct. So these four points should be made for four conditions leading to transcript to third type of research. And when the reference to the first condition also, so this mentioned that 20 kinds of women with whom men should have no sexual relations. Briefly, we can mention that the husband and wife can maintain sexual behavior. So among these 20 types of women with whom men should not have some kind of sexual behavior relations should be divided into 3 points that we can mention here. Women under the guardianship of parents and family members and relatives and authorities charged with their care. And second type of women are married or betrothed women. A third type of women are bhikkhunis and religious women, observing holy life. For all of these women, a man forbidden by tradition or under religious rules is prohibited as a partner. For any unwilling partner who is drunk or forced to have sexual intercourse under threat of violence or coercion, conditions under second and fourth exclude them from violation of this research. And also the gravity and the transgression of this third type precept is also mentioned in the text on the Thessalon. The gravity of the offense is determined by the degree of lust, motivation, the action, and the qualities of the person against whom the transgression is committed. When the lust is very strong, even incest and rape can be committed, the most serious being the rape of an arahant who have attained sainthood. And when we discuss on the fourth precept, that is abstaining from false speeches or any kind of false speeches, again it's mentioned in Atasani, four facts or four conditions should be made to avoid this kind of transgression. So among them, first one is the statement must be untrue. So one should lie. This should be a false statement. And second one, there must be an intention to deceive. Again here, very much important fact is intention of the volition. And third fact is an effort must be made to deceive. There should be any kind of effort or process to deceive. And fourth point is the other person must know the meaning of what is expressed. That means to a person, when you say a lie, so that person also should realize the meaning of that expression. And the causes of this false speech also mentioned here because of the three types of defilements, greed, hatred, and delusion. So this kind of transgression of this precept occurs. Greed is a root cause when false speech is used to obtain material gain or status of for oneself or someone dear to oneself. And second point is hatred is the root cause when false speech is used to cause loss and bring harm and suffering to others. And third one is delusion is the root cause when it is used neither for one's gain nor to cause loss and harm to others, but for the sake of enjoyment, such as lying for the sake of a joke, exaggeration to spice up a story, or flattery to please others. And when we discuss on the gravity of the act of false speech, we can mention here, the gravity is light if little benefit is destroyed and heavy if a large benefit is described as a result of thought space. So according to the benefit, if the benefits lie, then the gravity also listens. And when the benefit is very much important and large, and the gravity is also increased one. The false food is also lasciva if the motivation is to save oneself or another from material loss or harm, but it becomes more severe if the motivation is to cause material loss or harm to others. And third point is, with regard to the recipient of a false speech, the gravity is greater if the recipient is morally superior person. So one has achieved the most superior situations, or is one's benefactor, while the gravity is less if the recipient has low moral qualities. According to the moral value also, the gravity depends. And the worst cases of falsehood are lying in a way that defames the Buddha and the Arahantas for making false claims of attainments of the jhanas, that's called mental absorptions, and the false claims of attainment of the malkas and false phalas, the path and fruits. In such a case, a monk is expelled from the Sangha, so that's called the Parojika. So it's very grave for monks also to lie for the some kind of the false claims, regarding the achievement of the jhanas, absorptions, and also the path and fruits, Sangha and follow. The fifth precept is abstain from taking any kind of intoxicant that lead to carelessness or heedlessness. In Arthasani, it's also mentioned that four facts should be made to occur this kind of transgression. The first point is there must be an intoxicant. And second point is there must be the intention to take it. Again, it's mentioned about volition, chetana. And third point is action must be taken to ingest it. And fourth point is there must be actual ingestion of intoxicant. And condition four, that is that there must be actual ingestion of the intoxicant, states clearly that the precept is broken once the intoxicant is ingested intentionally. It does not matter whether one is intoxicated or not as a result of the action. In taking medicines containing alcohol or intoxicating drugs, for medicinal or medical reasons, medicinal purposes, no breach of the precept is committed, for there is no transgression of this precept. This is because one's intention is to take the medicine to cure one's sickness. So with this fact, so we can conclude the discussion of the five precepts, how it transgresses five precepts. In Abhisandha Sutta, is described the benefits of observing five precepts and upholding these five precepts. As I mentioned earlier, when I started this Dhamma talk, so it's mentioned that in the Bhikkhave Arisaoko, Anadipatam Pahaya, Anadipata Pativiritoko. The meaning of this text is there is a case where a disciple of the noble ones abandoning the taking of life of a living being. Abstains from taking life. And Manatipata Patuidu Vikma Arisavaku Aprimanana Satana Abhayandeti Avedandeti Abhyapachandeti. So in doing so, that means abstain from taking life. He gives freedom from danger. And he gives freedom from animosity. And he gives freedom from oppression. Aprimanana Satana, that limitless numbers of beings. And again, it's mentioned in this sutra, aparimanana sattana abhyandatva avirandatva abhinapajandatva aparimanasya abhyasa avirasa abhyapajasa bhagi poti. In giving freedom from danger and freedom from animosity, freedom from oppression to limitless numbers of beings, he gains us here for the portion in limitless freedom from danger, freedom from animosity, and freedom from oppression. So not only in this first precept, when one upholds any kind of this precept, that person gains such kind of benefit. That means that person gains a seer of in limitless freedom from danger, and from animosity, and freedom from oppression. So these are the benefits of upholding five precepts. And it's also described the benefits of taking refuge in triple jhana also in this sutta. So this is the brief brevity of this sutta. So with this, I would like to conclude this Dhamma talk, as we don't have a long time for this Dhamma talk. So lastly, I am very much thankful to Venerable Sumana, my brother Mara, to give me a chance to deliver a Dhamma talk on this auspicious occasion of Vaisakh Purnima Day. And the merit which accumulated through this meritorious deed, so we can pray for all the benefits of all the participants of the Dhamma talk, and also whole world, especially for safety from any kind of the harm, specifically the pandemic harms. May all be healthy and long life and prosperous with the blessings of triple jhana. With this, I conclude this Dhamma talk. Bhavatu Sabda Mangalam.